one of the United States tuna fleet have explored, developed, and fished the tropical waters of the eastern Pacific Ocean for nearly three generations, an area abundant in marine life for commercial fishing. Under the sponsorship of the National Marine Fisheries Service, the Marine Mammal Commission, the National Science Foundation, and the Tuna Industry's Porpoise Rescue Foundation, scientists aboard the tuna clipper Elizabeth C. Joe and fisheries research vessel David Starr Jordan recently studied the behavior of tuna and porpoise in the Pacific area known as the Yellowfin Regulatory Area. Objective? To help the tuna industry safeguard the porpoise populations vital to her livelihood. New beautifully designed tuna clippers and modern pulsating methods of catching the yellowfin tuna have not always been available for these men of America's tuna industry. In 1926, the first large tuna vessel in America, built and operated by Erno Medina of San Diego, pioneered the way for a multi-million dollar tuna clipper fleet that flourished several decades later. Fabricated their own lures and relied on skillful instincts to locate the elusive yellowfin tuna. Earlier methods of using bait fish to attract the tuna were effective but time-consuming, and oft-times disappointing if the small fish was scarce or elusive. Today, the fishermen must contend with 200-mile coastal limits off the coast of Latin America. Limited navigation and equipment and the use of small craft, quite primitive in contrast to the 230-foot clippers of today's fishing fleet, demanded the utmost skill of these seafaring men. Erno Medina remembers.
I brought the first tuna in the San Diego in November of 1919. The work in those days was very hard and the hours were very long. Sometimes we would go for many weeks without seeing any fish. When we did catch fish, we had to get them back to Fort Fast because our ice would melt and spoil the tuna. It was not an easy way to make a living.
Anchovy and sardines, the effective bait fish, are becoming more difficult to catch because of restrictive coastal boundaries. The American fishermen have caught yellowfin tuna associated with porpoise since the turn of the century. In this early era of the bait and pole method of retrieving the fish, work was only for the hardiest of men. Their catch usually yielded a small percentage of tuna in direct competition with foreign fleets importing the highly nutritious tuna. For the American fishermen, perhaps the most talented in the world, a new method of fishing for the prize tuna was needed. Pulsating muscle, a new concept of fishing technology, was the answer for the survival of America's first industry. New horizons for the fishermen forever. By herding the air-breathing mammals into their nets, the fishermen found that the entire school of tuna might fall. But as with any innovation, it brought problems as well. The fishermen wanted to catch tuna and did not want to kill porpoise. But porpoise mortality became inevitable, and the animals became entangled in the nets. Then in 1971, Captain Harold Medina successfully experimented with fine mesh webbing that made the nets safer for porpoise. This webbing, which came to be known as the Medina panel, along with the use of the backbound procedure, which released porpoise from the net, heralded the beginning of a concerted effort to save porpoise and improve fishing technique as well. National Marine Fisheries Service researchers, these concepts were further extended and improved on many scientific occasions. But more information was essential. Therefore, another scientific cruise was undertaken in October of 1976 to document the behavior and acoustical environment of tuna and porpoise, and to evaluate promising porpoise rescue gear and techniques. A first-hand observation was vital.
Nowadays, we have the method of using oyster boats to get at a tuna, which helps us a lot, a real lot. Without those, it would be pretty hard to do a lot of times, you know. And things are changing.
China since 1961. We've come a long ways with our boats, equipment, everything is more up to date. And we have to, compete with the other country, we have to stay up with it. But we do have really nice ships.
Next, more white cloud silhouetted against the sky, the porpoise head for the open sea. Scientific research is a must. Dr. Warren Stuntz of the University of California at Santa Cruz recalls.
This was my first trip out on a fish sonar, so I learned an incredible amount about porpoise, about fishermen, and we even managed to, I think, learn some things that may eventually help in solving the tuna porpoise problem. In particular, we saw that porpoise could be easily moved around the net. Of course, it's been known for years that porpoise could be herded around and that rather simple devices would do it. We saw many examples of this on this trip when we had divers in the water. Another fact that came out of this that was really pretty exciting, once again, it was something that had been seen before by Jim Coe of the National Marine Fisheries Service several years ago, but it hadn't been broadcast widely, and that was the animal's sleep. We called it sleeping behavior. What they do is go down and bring back down, and lay down in the bottom of the net. We were lucky enough to get some films of that behavior where you've got about 80 or 100 animals laying there in the bottom of the net. They look like they're dead, but in fact they're quite well. And down there, either out of frustration or for some other reason. And if you simply give them a few minutes during back down, they'll come shooting back up to the surface, take a breath, and at that time, you can back them out of the net.
In the tropical eastern Pacific, learned of a unique achievement of fishermen and scientists. It has heralded in the beginning of the era of newer techniques of marine mammal and tuna conservation. Together just before hauling in begins, the giant yellow fin must be closely observed and could follow the purpose from the river. The final minutes of gathering in the net, the man's precision handiwork, and utmost importance of the crew's working relationship as a team. Every minute of a commercial fishing set is fatiguing, and no opportunity for rest occurs until the tuna are stored on board the first sea. At the final phase of this data mission, the giant net is winched on board the sea jelly, carefully and systematically. At the end of 1976, the American tuna fishermen in the eastern tropical Pacific landed more tuna on the U.S. mainland than any period in commercial fishing history. Been completed that nearly 99% of all porpoise found and encircled by U.S. tuna fishing vessels are released unharmed. To understand the problems of any at-sea research, it is essential to participate in the endeavor and then analyze the data. Compiled facts and the data received of all phases of this fishing operation will greatly aid U.S. fishermen who fish the oceans of the world.